Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory with great warranties. Fabulous and a wide array of pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee and a service department that backs it all up with such great technicians. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf. Online at sunburymotors.com. Our play-by-play call of the day, nowhere else to turn. Dan Snyder is going to sell the commander. No, that's not. We're going to actually go with a sports one. I thought you wanted to do a TMZ show. No?
No, we'll stick to sports this time.
So you're going to do the Harper home run?
Correct.
Okay, we'll do this. It's actually more fun.
At some point, McCullers has to throw him fastballs to keep him honest. But Bryce is so good against off-speed, and we know he likes to swing early and swing big. If he stays on the breaking ball and gets the one in the middle of the plate, loud noise.
McCullers to Harper.
It's good. Right center field. Lightning strikes. 2-0 Phils.
Bryce Harper has put the Phillies on top with a two-run home run over the out-of-town scoreboard. Simply amazing. Harper here at home has homered on back-to-back swings.
Well, Johnny sure looked ready for a curveball.
He sat on it, and he got it. Look, you look at film all the time, and you watch at-bats, and you can just tell sometimes a great hitter is going to take away one of the strengths of the opposing pitcher, and he sure did it on the first pitch.
John Smoltz, Joe Davis, and then Scott Fransky with the shot heard around Philly last night. One of five home runs hit by the Phils. Kyle Schwarber, Rhys Hoskins, Marsh, and Schwarber, Marsh, Hoskins, Harper. Who was the fifth one last night? Ding, ding, ding. Oh, Alec Bohm. How about that? 7-0 they won it. Cristian Javier tonight, Aaron Nola for the Phils. All right, let's get to Indiana football. The first ever winner of the Woody Durham Award, Don Fischer. Now he has won the Chris Schenkel Award, which will be at the National Football Foundation and College Hall of Fame in December. 50th season announcing Indiana football and basketball. And as athletic director Pat Kraft says to me, he says, Don Fischer, he's the greatest. Donnie, welcome. Great to have you with us.
Well, Pat's a little non-objective about that. You realize that, of course.
Oh, I do, but still. I mean, I've already heard it before.
Did you start crying at that point?
No, you don't usually bring me to tears, Don. No.
I know how I can bring you to tears.
Oh, I know you
can. Chris Reynolds?
Oh, yeah. Excuse me for a moment. I'm starting to choke up just a bit. Sure, it was just a little tug of the jersey.
Yeah. It wasn't noticeable.
It wasn't noticeable, at least two of them.
Exactly right.
Oh, God.
Exactly right.
Yes, Don and I are two of the survivors of that night. And also the other one's Tim Brando, by the way, in Rec Hall.
That's right.
I had so many fans. Like, this happened for like 10 years. It's the greatest game I ever went to. I said, what do you think? And I said, they lost. What do you... I said, no. I said, here's Don's number. Call him and ask him. He said, no.
No, I think Indiana did win that game. I do think they did win that game.
Oh, my goodness. I'll say this. In the second overtime, Penn State's up, and then Indiana hit a gear, and Damon Bailey played great. So,
yeah.
All right. Enough of that. I'm starting to shake. So
well, now I know who's going to shake next.
I know.
Because we're going to talk about football.
Yeah, and you know what? What people may not realize is Illinois has one loss, and it's Indiana that inflicted the loss. And to you, it must feel like it was like a year ago because it was right back at the beginning. What has changed from the team that started out with three straight wins, including Illinois, if anything?
Well, not much. And the truth of the matter is Illinois should have won that game. And they did not, in my opinion, because they screwed up. They screwed up at the end because they, on the last drive of the ball game, Indiana had less than 2 minutes left in the contest. They were down, obviously, and they had to score a touchdown to win the ball game. And Illinois went into a prevent defense. Indiana went 79 yards and scored the touchdown with a few seconds left on the clock to win the contest. And that prevent defense allowed DJ Matthews to get out by probably – he had like four catches on the drive.
Yeah.
And I guarantee you there were three of those catches that nobody was within 10 yards of him.
Yeah.
And how they could not be on that guy is beyond me. But they gave that – they gave the game to Indiana because Connor Bazelak, he knew he could throw wherever he wanted to throw it. There wasn't going to be anybody but an Indiana player there. It was amazing.
That normally helps. I mean, I'm not as experienced as you, but I think that normally helps.
Yeah, I think it does. There's no question about it. So yeah. I'm sure they're still lamenting that decision to play a prevent-type defense in that situation because, obviously, had they just played their normal defense, they probably would have won the game.
What have you thought of the tempo part of it? Because Indiana's averaging about 18 seconds a play, and the FBS number's about 26 a play. What have you thought of that?
Well, I thought about it early. I thought it was pretty good. I thought it helped Indiana. It hasn't helped them since. And I say that, number one, because if you're not moving the ball, if you're going 1-2-3 and out, you're just putting your defense back in the field consistently. And that's what's happened since then. Even though they were able to win the next two ball games after that, and this team probably should have won the fourth one because Cincinnati was there to be had.
Yeah.
And Indiana didn't. They blew it in that contest. And ever since then, it's been downhill. It's been a downhill struggle for this football team. The truth of the matter is at this point, Indiana's offense has struggled mightily throughout the year, and even though they had those three comeback wins to start the season, they were all comeback wins. It wasn't like Indiana did anything to dominate the offensive side of the football at that point, and they haven't really – they played – they obviously against Rutgers this past – or 2 weeks ago or a week and a half ago now. Against Rutgers, they got off to their best start of the season. It was 14-0 midway through the first quarter, and the offense went stale the rest of the ball game. I think there was one drive in the second period in which they were going extremely well down the field, and their best receiver on this football team, Cam Camper, got hurt, and he's out for the year with an ACL. And that, of course, has spelled the doom for this football team so far.
And with him out, where does the focus now go to in that wide receiver core? I know you mentioned Matthews, so he's obviously one.
Well, he is probably the guy it should go to because he's been hurt, too. He's been hurt for the last several weeks. Yeah. He came back 2 weeks ago, didn't look like himself. He played last week against Rutgers and still didn't look like he was much of a factor. Hopefully, with the bye week that's in between now, that's given him more time to get ready, and maybe he will be the player that we anticipate that he can be because we've seen it before. But again, last year he got hurt the same way, and he was out for the rest of the season after the Western Kentucky game. So we still haven't seen DJ Matthews, with the exception of maybe three or four games in his 2 years at Indiana where he has been much of a factor. But he would be the guy that would probably take over the role that Cam Camper had, if, in fact, he can do it.
Right. What kind of jump has the freshman Jalen Lucas added in the running game?
Well, he's helped There's no question. If my feeling on Jalen Lucas is he's not a big kid. He's 5'9", probably weighs about 185. And probably needs to be one of those guys that you just try to get him the ball in space. Mm-hmm. If you get him the ball in space, he can dramatically affect a football game. He's already, last week, of course, he ran back a kickoff for a touchdown, 93 yards out. He's dynamic when he has the ball in space. When he doesn't, so far, at this point, he's still not strong enough. He's a true freshman. He just can't pound it in there like some of the other backs
sure.
can.
Right.
Obviously, the Henderson kid's been probably pretty good, the best at that. The Shivers kid from Auburn, you know, he looked like he was going to be a real factor in fall camp. I thought he really would be because he'd love to take it up inside and banged into our defensive mm-hmm. guys and still made yards happen. He hasn't done that since fall practices because he got absolutely lit up the first time he touched the football against Illinois, and I don't think he's been the same player since.
Right.
He's a tough kid, but he just hasn't run with the same kind of authority since that time. And he's had a couple of breakaways, and he's very quick and athletic too. But honestly, the run game has just been a big problem because the offensive line has not shown themselves again this year.
Yeah, it sounds like Josiah Sears is going to get a start at the tackle, it sounds like. What have you thought of Connor Bazelak running this? I know that Tom has said, you know, everything's open, but I'll at least ask you about the veteran.
I like him. I like Connor a lot. Number one, I like him because he's just tougher than nails. He is really a tough kid, and he's had to be with that offensive line because they haven't protected him worth a nickel.
Yeah.
I'm sure that his mindset has gone from being just a tough guy to I need to move and get out of the way because he's been hit so many times. But I do think he's a good kid, a good quarterback. If he's got the time to throw the football, he can get it where it needs to go. But I do think that Tom Allen has evaluated everything during this bye week period, and he has made no commitment that Connor will be the starting quarterback on Saturday against Penn State. If he's not, who will it be? Because Jack Tuttle has already announced that he's in the transfer portal.
That's right.
He is still on the team.
Yep.
Thomas kept him as a captain, and he is probably listed as the number two guy. But my question is, you've got a kid sitting in the wings named Dexter Williams who is a run and throw guy. He can do both. He's got a really good arm. He was touted as probably the player who made the most improvement on the football team at the end of fall practice sessions from a year ago to now. He had to deal with an injury last year. It looks like he's 100% healthy. I would love to see him, if they have to go to make a change here to try to shake things up, I'd love to see him be the guy. I just don't know whether he will or not.
Right. Defensively, on paper, many thought the Indiana secondary would be one of the better ones in the Big Ten. It doesn't seem like it's played out that way. Is that accurate?
That's accurate. I don't know why. We have not been as aggressive, in my opinion, as we were a couple of years ago when we ran blitzes almost every play and disrupted the quarterbacks on the opposing teams, not because our front four was able to do much, but with all the blitzing that we did, it shook the other teams up. I mean, the Ohio State game a couple of years ago was a perfect example. Justin Fields, he had no clue what was going to happen in that ball game, and he struggled until they got the game in hand in the fourth quarter. But we haven't played that way, and we haven't played that way for 2 years now. I don't quite understand that aspect of it. I think Tom is a terrific defensive guy.
I agree.
And knows he's a terrific coordinator.
Yep.
I mean, he really was. But and even though he's taken over the play calling this year, it's not worked. It's just not been the same. And I'm not quite sure what the answer there is. I know Taiwan Mullen came off of an injury last year that he hasn't been the same guy, and I know he's a great kid and really a good football player.
Yes, he is.
But he hasn't played the same way. And Jalen Williams has had a good year, but not a great year. He was the other guy in the defensive corner position that has been really solid throughout his career. And I think a big problem with this football team right now is the tempo, because they go so fast that 1-2-3 and out keeps the defense out there way too long. And honestly, I think they wear out. The second half, we're just not the same defense.
24 minutes a game of possession for Indiana, 36 for the opponent. At least the averages through eight games so far.
Yeah, and you got to remember we had the ball a lot against Idaho.
Yeah, true. That's true. What has the Cam Jones injury meant? I know Casey's played well, so I'm not taking anything away from him. But to me, Cam's an exceptional player. So what's that meant?
Well, it's meant a lot because he is the leader of this defense. And him being out, you're still a verbal or a vocal leader on the sidelines and all that kind of stuff. And he's embraced that role as best he can. But his absence has meant a lot to this football team because Aaron Casey is now playing his spot. Mm-hmm. Before he was alongside Cam. And so he's playing a different role. It shoves a couple of guys in there. Bradley Jennings is a kid that was transferred in, and Jared Casey's another. Both those guys have played quite a bit, and they're solid, but they're not Cam Jones.
Right.
And so your best defensive football player on this team has been out now for 4 weeks, hasn't played since the Nebraska ball game, and this team has struggled mightily.
So what's the perception of the program around Bloomington right now? I mean, because Tom obviously 2 years had it going. There was a lot of excitement. I remember listening to your bowl game. What's the perception of it right now, especially with the job, like, for example, Mike Woodson seems to be doing with the basketball side of it?
Well, obviously, we're not in the same ballpark as the basketball program.
Exactly.
And I think most people really revere Tom as a great person. I think they think he's a really good coach in many respects. I just don't know. You get out there in the public and people are going, it's basketball season, kind of stuff. And
yep.
it has happened a lot over the years. I've been here 50, so I've seen it happen many times here. It's just not the same as it was during the Bill Mallory era. Even when Bill Mallory's teams weren't great, there was always a feeling that they were going to bust their gut for that coach and for that team and for the program, and they were going to get better as a team and as a unit, and the players would get better through development, those kinds of things. Have we seen that with this program? I honestly don't think we have. And I think the development aspect of it is such a critical thing in Indiana because we don't get the 4 and the 5-star guys. You know, we got a few, but we don't get many. And because of that, you've got to coach kids up and you've got to develop them. On this particular staff, they have 5 new coaches, now 6, because they fired the offensive line coach a couple of weeks back.
Yep.
And Rod Carey takes over. And I think Rod Carey, if he'd had this offensive line from spring practice on, I think this would be a different offensive line because I think that guy's a great coach. But
I agree.
Rod Carey took over, and he was actually just here learning. After he left Temple, Tom coached him and asked him to just be a quality control coach if he wanted to. He wanted to see his own son play football at the high school level. And so he came here for that very reason, so he could do that on Friday nights. But now he's back coaching the offensive line again, which I don't think he wanted to take the job, and he cleared it with his wife and his son.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I don't think he really wants the job because he wants to see his kid play, and I don't blame him. You know, I don't blame him a bit. And at this juncture, he has the offensive line. And I think he made a little bit of a difference the first week. The second week, you didn't see it as much. I don't know if he can do the job with this offensive line. I don't know if the talent's good enough. But I do think that if he would have had that program or had our program at the offensive line position from the beginning of last spring up to this point, we would be a different football team.
Right. I agree with him. From us to you, congratulations on a well-deserved Chris Schenkel Award. I know you're humble about it, but you earned it. And it doesn't matter about longevity. You would have earned it if you'd had it. It had been 10, 15 years, okay? But congratulations.
Well, quite nice for you to say, Steve. I really appreciate it. But, honestly, you're a part of a team no matter who you're doing in this life.
No doubt.
And I've had a lot of great people around me. Buck Sewer, of course, who retired at the end of last season as my analyst in football, was just the best ever. I mean, he was so good. And
Jack loves Buck. loves him.
Yeah, well, absolutely he loves him because if you don't love Bucks or you don't like football.
Yeah, you don't like people.
Exactly. And Buck was so much fun to work with. And I got a really good young guy now. Rhett Kleinschmidt is his real name, but he goes by Rhett Lewis.
Yeah.
He's on the NFL Network. He flies in from Los Angeles every week to wherever we're at or here in Bloomington to do the games. He is a former IU graduate and wanted to be the new color analyst when Buck hung it up, and we hired him because he's really good. Yeah. So we've got another really good one. So I've been very fortunate to have some of the best color analysts in the business in both football and basketball. That's a big part of why we've had success.
Always a pleasure, my friend. I'm really looking forward to seeing you on Saturday.
Steve, it was great listening to all those comments in regard to all the stuff that happened this time of the year or this day in sports history. Yeah, the day in sports history. You know, the 1892 comment. I'd live that. You know,
that. I said I was there. I mean, that the running joke that he and I have when we do a basketball game is that he's in his. Now we can use the different numbers. He's in his 50th. I'm in my 41st. I'm the baby of the group.
Well, you know what? Everybody's the baby of the group when it comes to me. So I get it.
Yeah, and guess what? We all look up to you. So all of us do with deep respect. Thank
you. You don't set the bar high, boys. I'm glad of that.
That's always been my standard. Donnie, you're the best. As Pat Kraft says, Don Fischer, he's the greatest.
You tell Pat I said hello. I will. I get a chance to see him this weekend.
You bet. Thanks, Don.
You bet. Say it to me.
Don Fischer, the legendary play-by-play voice of Indiana football and basketball. And I just want to take a moment and apologize to Matt.
No, I love Don Fischer. I want to meet him, too. That was fun.
You want to talk about the juicy stuff, and I do stupid stuff like talk about games. I'm sorry.
Well, this is a good segment.
Feel better. We'll come back with more in a moment on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, the best in new inventory, and they all have great warranties. And a great warranty does so much for you. The peace of mind, that's a big part. Now, the budget may say, I need to get a pre-owned vehicle. Well, you better go with one that has the Sunbury Motors guarantee. Big difference. And the service department, great technicians. They'll take care of the life of any vehicle. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. So we talked to Tyler Donahue about Drew Aller. We talked to Don Fischer about Indiana. Matt wants to talk about all the TMZ stuff. I talked about the World Series. That disappointed Matt because he wanted to talk about the Commanders. It's been another tough show for you.
I'm fine with all those topics, too. It's been a busy sports day.
Nobody wants to talk about the stuff you want to talk about. I don't understand. They hired a bank to explore the Commander sale. Oh. So we got to do like 2 hours on that? Fans here in our area are just juiced over the World Series. And tonight it's Aaron Nola against Cristian Javier. Do not write off Cristian Javier. You may not know much about him, especially when he's the number four starter. But the guy is over six innings and strike out his fair share. And they have won his last seven starts, or last eight starts. They've won. Beat the Yankees, didn't he? Yeah. I didn't want to bring that up.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
I feel awful about that.
Yeah. But also, too, I mean, I don't know how confident, if I'm a Phillies fan, I don't know how confident I feel in Aaron Nola tonight, to be honest with you. He's not been good the last two starts. How does he bounce back tonight? That's my big question mark.
Well, and again, he had been pitching so well, and then he got to the World Series and he had a speed bump. Let's be honest about it, though. A big part of what's happening here is the Astros, for whatever reason, have stopped hitting. They did not hit last night. So it's one thing, the 7-0, the five home runs. Neither team really tapped into their bullpen last night, so both teams were in great shape there. Oh, they used bullpen guys, but they used the back of the bullpen guys. But that's a, you know. So that's where that stands. I mean, I think whomever wins the first six innings tonight wins the game. Because either team can go to its bullpen, they can make the last three innings a nightmare for whomever. Very interesting. And the Phillies power show has been fun to watch. It's been fun to watch. No question. Some other key games coming up. We're going to talk about this tomorrow, obviously. Oh, one other. Let me get to two other stories here. Let's start very quickly. We'll go to Deion Sanders. Said he will not allow his players to leave the hotel this weekend when they face Texas Southern in Houston. As a rapper was shot and killed at a bowling alley early Tuesday morning. Okay. So I understand where he's coming from here, except every team I've ever been around, except for bowl games, the players don't leave the hotel. No offense, but they don't leave the hotel. Everything is so structured between meetings, meals, designated rest times, and so forth. It's a business trip. You don't leave the hotel. Now, bowl games are different. You're leaving the hotel a lot. Regular season game, no. So it really should not be an issue. I'm not going to pretend I know the Jackson State travel schedule. I don't. I just know the travel schedules I've been around over the years, and you don't leave the hotel. Nobody does. Because it's a business trip. When the players have meetings, players have mandatory meals, film, things like that, leading right up until the time they leave. And you're not there that long anyway. But thought I'd bring it up. Four more Michigan State players suspended for that brawl in the tunnel. So far, they have suspended linebacker Tank Brown, doesn't play. Angelo Gross starts. Defensive end Zion Young doesn't play. Cornerback Kari Crump plays a lot. They then added in Jacoby Windham, who plays a ton at defensive end. Brandon Wright, who plays a lot at defensive end. Justin White, who plays a lot in the secondary. And Malcolm Jones, who does not play at all. Herman Green and Jaden McBurrows are considering civil suits. But that is, I mean, I don't know if you've seen the video. Have you seen the video?
Oh, yeah. That was ugly.
Look, Michigan football is a $100 million business. Take some money, build a second tunnel. Or take some money and build an offshoot to the first tunnel. Because, look, there's areas underneath the stands you can get to. But Michigan State has one tunnel. Rutgers has one tunnel. Michigan has one tunnel. Washington has one tunnel. Notre Dame has one tunnel. USC has one tunnel. Those are the ones off the top of my head that I can think of that have one, at least the places I've been.
But I'm sorry, Jim Harbaugh has bigger fish to fry.
F-O-U-L-E-D, that spells foul stuff.
As I've said many times before, but I'll say it again, Jim Harbaugh does not care at all about my opinion. To which my response is, what a coincidence. Big games this weekend. Besides Penn State, of course, they've got their game in Indiana. Here are some of the games this weekend that are pretty intriguing. Friday, tomorrow night's game is actually a pretty good one. Oregon State, Washington, 2-6-2 teams playing at Husky Stadium. Interesting. You've got Tennessee, Georgia. 2-8-0 teams head-to-head in Athens. Wow. Big time. Alabama and LSU is the 7 o'clock game on Saturday. 7-1 Alabama, 6-2 LSU. I know you're mad about the LSU thing. I got it. But he's actually done a pretty good job. Clemson and Notre Dame. Clemson's 8-0, fourth in this college football playoff poll. And Notre Dame's coming off a great win against Syracuse. Clemson's still a 3.5-point favorite at South Bend. And Wake Forest and NC State are 2-6-2 teams head-to-head. So they got some pretty good games this weekend. Kansas State's at home. They got Texas. Texas 5-3. Kansas State 6-2. And with the backup quarterback. Remember I said that when we were picking games? We all picked Oklahoma State. And my only question was I wanted to know if Adrian Martinez was playing. If Martinez was playing, I would have picked Kansas State. Well, he didn't play. And the other quarterback, Will Howard, stepped in, and he threw 5 touchdown passes. Okay, great. Good call by me. Brutal. Brutal. Some pretty good games this weekend. And, of course, the Eagles will play tomorrow night when they've got the Texans down in Houston. Let's see. Any games where both teams were over 500 this weekend? Bills and Jets, 6-1, 5-3. And the Titans and the Chiefs, both 5-2. Those are the only two games this weekend where both teams are over 500. The NFL has a little bit of a problem. They're not getting great matchups. We only have two games in a given weekend, and we're only 8 weeks into the season. And you can't get, it turns out you're not getting any games with teams over 500. Last weekend there was one. This weekend there are two. Wow. And the Titans-Chiefs game is the Sunday night game. The Bills and Jets will play at 1 o'clock on CBS. And the Bills are still 12.5-point favorites. Wow. All right, we'll take a break. He knows Matt has not been talking a lot. He's been going through the internet trying to find all the Daniel Snyder dirt he can find. You want to talk about somebody who's been a disaster for the league? That's him. Wow. Unreal. Back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
First of all, it's not a decision that I make on my own. I want to, you know, whenever there's big decisions like that, I want to make sure that I'm not too close to it. So I had a pretty good conversation with Mike Yurcich, obviously, Manny Diaz, Coach Wiz, talked to Danny O'Brien. So I talked to the guys that either been a college or NFL head coach before. Also talked to a guy who played the position as well and got everybody's thoughts. And we'll continue to evaluate it. And I understand the question. I truly do. But it almost comes off to me as if this game is not really important. For us, we're going to look at who gives us the best chance to be 1-0 this week. There's still a ton of football left to be played. The question, I don't necessarily love the tone of it, but I get it. To me, it's an interesting question.
So we'll see how it plays out. Fabulous prospect, no doubt about it. Love watching him throw the football. And looking at him getting better in a lot of different ways as time goes. It's always interesting because I'm not going to sit there and tell you I'm the educated eye of Ken Wisenhunt or Manny Diaz or Mike Yurcich or Danny O'Brien or James. No, I'm not going to do that. But I do see usually quarterbacks throw about, I don't know, maybe in the neighborhood of 4,000 passes a year, a piece in practice. And I'm not exaggerating. So, to a point, I can see what they're talking about, and anything I have questions about, I ask. And it's a great resource to ask a Ken Wisenhunt or a Mike Yurcich or a Danny O'Brien or James what their thoughts happen to be. They know more about it than I do. But when I'm asking questions, I'm not asking from the disadvantage of not seeing. And again, it's the advantage of doing what I do. No getting around it. There's nothing you can... The media, which is probably there right now, they get 10 minutes a week to see what's going on. Right? So that's not a lot, but they get some. Most schools don't give any right now. And so in a short period of time, you have to make some thoughts and some evaluations about what's going on. I have the advantage of seeing a lot of it. Seeing how they react to throwing interceptions, seeing how they react to a fumble, seeing how they react to making a big play, seeing how they react to sequencing plays, things like that. And again, he is a fabulous prospect, but Bo Prabhul is a really terrific prospect. Believe me. I mean, you haven't really seen Bo, but Bo's a terrific prospect as well. Christian Bayer. So we'll see what he wants to do with it. I think I got a pretty good idea of it. That's for him to talk about and for me to observe. Phillies tonight. Aaron Nola. One of the spots he's always wanted to be in. At home, trying to give his team a 3-1 lead in the series. Wow. How awesome's that? How cool LeVar Arrington sent a friend request on Facebook. He thinks highly of you. Yeah. How cool. It's great to see LeVar on Saturday. But what a moment tonight. And Cristian Javier, don't discount him. He's got some jump in his fastball. He's got good movement on his other pitches. They have won his last 8 starts. They won the last 9 games he's pitched in because he also pitched in relief in that 15-inning Seattle game in the playoffs. The idea for each manager, Robbie Thompson of the Phillies and Dusty Baker of the Astros, is probably to get 6 innings out of their starter tonight and then let their bullpens take her home. So we may see one of those six-inning games tonight. And last night, Bryce Harper electrified everybody with that home run to right. Wow, what a moment. And by the way, in the background, you know, it's just great to see the enthusiasm of those fans and so forth. I know you all think you're intimidating the Astros. It's okay. But you are boosting the Phillies. They have not lost at home in the playoffs. Yankees lost at home in the playoffs, didn't they?
Yeah, a couple times, actually.
Wasn't that nice the way that Harper came to the plate and they cheered him last night?
It was.
That doesn't happen everywhere. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
.62 home runs, not good enough for certain fans. All right. Tomorrow, our roundtable playoff version, right?
You got it.
Should be fun.